Winston S. Churchill, The Second World War, Volume 5, Closing the Ring. ...1943 and early 1944 were busy years for my grandfather, and the strain of war took its toll. He suffered a severe bout of pneumonia while in Tunis, but thankfully made a full recovery. That was important, for he needed all his wisdom and courage for the momentous decisions that had to be made during this period about Allied strategy for the prosecution of the war to final victory. Major war councils were held in Washington, Quebec, North Africa, Cairo, and Tehran. The latter was the first at which all three great wartime leaders, Churchill, Roosevelt, and Stalin, met together in conference. The discussions at most of these meetings centered on two main issues: the cross-channel invasion set for 1944, and how best to use Anglo-American forces in the meantime to strike at the Axis and relieve the pressure on the Soviets. And relief they still needed, with 185 German and other enemy divisions ranged against them on the Eastern Front. A less important matter, but nevertheless one that grew in importance over time, was the question of the character of the post-war world, how to deal with Germany, how to enforce the peace and create a new international system. After the defeat of the Africa Corps, there was a vigorous debate between the British and Americans about the next stage of the campaign in the Mediterranean. My grandfather favored an invasion of mainland Italy and the use of small forces in the Aegean to regain control there, which would help Allied ambitions in Greece, Yugoslavia, and Turkey, and would open a new supply route to the Soviets through the Dardanelles. At no time did my grandfather wish to undermine Overlord, the code name for the cross-channel invasion. And he explains this at several points in his narrative. The Americans were more cautious and worried by the constraints imposed upon Allied operations by the shortage of landing craft for amphibious operations. In the end, my grandfather got most of what he wanted, though too late to reap all the advantages that might have come with more adventurous and speedy decisions. Italy was invaded, and great advances were made until operations bogged down late in 1943. In Yugoslavia, Tito's partisans became ever more active, and together with the campaign in Italy, tied down many German divisions that might otherwise have been used in Normandy or on the Eastern Front.
The reasons which led me to hasten to Washington once the decision in Africa was certain were serious. What should we do with our victory? Were its fruits to be gathered only in the Tunisian tip? Or should we drive Italy out of the war and bring Turkey in on our side? These were fateful questions, which could only be answered by a personal conference with the president. A second only to these were the plans for action in the Indian theater. I was conscious of serious divergences beneath the surface, which, if not adjusted, would lead to grave difficulties and feeble action during the rest of the year. I was resolved to have a conference on the highest possible level. The doctors did not want me to fly at the great height required in a bomber, and it was therefore decided to go by sea. We left London on the night of May the 4th and went aboard the Queen Mary and the Clyde the following day. The conference, which I had christened Trident, was to last at least a fortnight and was intended to cover every aspect of the war. We had to think about all the theaters at once. Upon the operations in Europe, following the victory in Africa, we were in complete agreement. It had been decided at Casablanca to attack Sicily, and all preparations were far advanced. The British chiefs of staff were convinced that an attack upon the mainland of Italy should follow, or even overlap, the capture of Sicily. They proposed the seizure of a bridgehead on the toe of Italy, to be followed by a further assault on the heel, as prelude to an advance on Bari and Naples. A paper setting out these views, and the arguments which led up to them, was prepared on board ship, and handed to the American chiefs of staff as a basis for discussion on our arrival in Washington. We anticipated more difficulties in reaching agreement with our American friends over the second great sphere of British military action, namely the operations from India. Many plans had been set forth on paper, but we had little to show in fact. The President and his circle still cherished exaggerated ideas of the military power which China could exert, if given sufficient arms and equipment. They also feared unduly the imminence of a Chinese collapse if support were not forthcoming. I disliked thoroughly the idea of reconquering Burma by an advance along the miserable communications to Assam. I hated jungles, which go to the winner anyway, and thought in terms of air power, sea power, amphibious operations, and key points. It was, however, an essential to all our great business that our friends should not feel we had been slack in pulling our weight, and be convinced that we were ready to make the utmost exertions to meet their wishes. What happened in Burma will be recounted later. On May the 11th, we arrived off Staten Island. Harry Hopkins was there to meet us, and we immediately entrained for Washington. The President was on the platform to greet me, and whisked me off to my old rooms at the White House. The next afternoon, May the 12th, at 2:30 p.m., we all met in his Oval Study to survey and lay out our work at the conference. Mr. Roosevelt asked me to open the discussion. According to the record, the essence of my thought was as follows. We should never forget that there were 185 German divisions on the Russian front. We had destroyed the German army in Africa, but soon we should not be in contact with them anywhere. The Russian effort was prodigious and placed us in their debt. The best way of taking the weight off the Russian front in 1943 would be to get or knock Italy out of the war, thus forcing the Germans to send a large number of troops to hold down the Balkans. We had a large army and the Metropolitan Fighter Air Force in Great Britain. We had our finest and most experienced troops in the Mediterranean. The British alone had 13 divisions in northwest Africa. Supposing that Sicily was completed by the end of August, what should these troops do between that time and the date in 1944, 7 or 8 months later, when the cross-channel operation might first be mounted? They could not possibly stand idle, and so long a period of apparent inaction would have a serious effect on Russia, who was bearing such a disproportionate weight. Mr. Roosevelt agreed that to relieve Russia, we must engage the Germans. But he questioned the occupation of Italy, which would release German troops to fight elsewhere. He thought that the best way of forcing Germany to fight would be to launch an operation across the Channel. I replied that as we were now agreed, we could not do this till 1944. It seemed imperative to use our great armies to attack Italy. I did not think that an occupation of the whole peninsula would be necessary. If Italy collapsed, the United Nations would occupy the ports and airfields needed for further operations into the Balkans and southern Europe. An Italian government could control the country, subject to Allied supervision. All these grave issues were now to be thrashed out by our combined staffs and their experts. The discussions continued, much helped by the skill and tact of Harry Hopkins. But I was disturbed that no definite decision had been taken regarding the invasion of Italy after the conquest of Sicily. In the end, it was agreed that General Marshall should accompany me to Algiers to discuss matters further with General Eisenhower. The circumstances of our meeting were favorable to the British. We had 3 times as many troops, 4 times as many warships, and almost as many aeroplanes available for actual operations as the Americans. We had, since Alamein, not to speak of the earlier years, lost in the Mediterranean 8 times as many men and 3 times as many ships as our allies. But what ensured for these potent facts the fairest and most attentive consideration with the American leaders was that notwithstanding our immense preponderance of strength, we had continued to accept General Eisenhower's supreme command and to preserve for the whole campaign the character of a United States operation. The American chiefs do not like to be outdone in generosity. No people respond more spontaneously to fair play. If you treat Americans well, they always want to treat you better. Nevertheless, I consider that the argument which convinced the Americans was on its merits overwhelming. The meeting with Eisenhower went well. The proposal that gained general support involved 2 possible courses of action. The first, favored from the beginning by the Americans, was an invasion of Sardinia and Corsica. The second was the invasion of mainland Italy. The final decision between these two options would be made once the course of events in the Sicilian campaign was clear. We met again on the afternoon of May the 31st. Mr. Eden arrived in time to be present. I tried to clinch matters and said my heart lay in an invasion of southern Italy, but the fortunes of battle might necessitate a different course. At any rate, the alternative between southern Italy and Sardinia involved the difference between a glorious campaign and a mere convenience. General Marshall was in no way hostile to these ideas, but did not wish for a clear-cut decision to be taken at this moment. He, General Eisenhower, and the combined chiefs of staff were fully aware of my feelings about invading Italy, but their only desire was to select the post-Sicily alternative, which would give the best results. An incident now occurred which, as it relates to matters which have become the subject of misunderstandings and controversy after the war, must be related. Mr. Eden, at my request, commented on the Turkish situation and said that knocking Italy out of the war would go a long way towards bringing the Turks in. They would become much more friendly when our troops had reached the Balkan area. Eden and I were in full agreement on war policy, but I feared that the turn of his phrase might mislead our American friends. The record states, the Prime Minister intervened to observe emphatically that he was not advocating sending an army into the Balkans now or in the near future. Mr. Eden agreed that it would not be necessary to put an army into the Balkans, since the Turks would begin to show favorable reactions as soon as we were able to constitute an immediate threat to the Balkans. Before we separated, I asked General Alexander to give his view. He did so in an extremely impressive speech. Securing a bridgehead on the Italian mainland should be part of the plan. It would be impossible for us to win a great victory unless we could exploit it by moving ahead, preferably up into Italy. He was at once supported by Admiral Cunningham, who said that if all went well in Sicily, we should go directly across the straits. Eisenhower concluded the meeting by expressing appreciation of the journey which General Marshall and I had made to clarify for him what the combined chiefs of staff had done. He understood it was his responsibility to get information regarding the early phases of the invasion of Sicily and forward them to the combined chiefs of staff in time for them to decide on the plan which would follow without a break or a stop. He would send not only information, but also strong recommendations based upon the conditions of the moment. I felt that great advances had been made in our discussions and that everybody wanted to go for Italy. I therefore, in summing up at our last meeting on June the 3rd, stated the conclusions in a most moderate form and paid my tribute to General Eisenhower. Eden and I flew home together by Gibraltar. As my presence in North Africa had been fully reported, the Germans were exceptionally vigilant, and this led to a tragedy which much distressed me. The regular commercial aircraft was about to start from the Lisbon airfield when a thick-set man smoking a cigar walked up and was thought to be a passenger on it. The German agents therefore signaled that I was on board. Although these passenger planes had plied unmolested for many months between Portugal and England, a German warplane was instantly ordered out, and the defenseless aircraft was ruthlessly shot down. 13 passengers perished, and among them the well-known British actor Leslie Howard, whose grace and gifts are still preserved for us by the records of the many delightful films in which he took part. The brutality of the Germans was only matched by the stupidity of their agents. We, of course, made a wide loop, out by night from Gibraltar into the ocean, and arrived home without incident. It was a painful shock to me to learn what had happened to others in the inscrutable workings of fate. We have now reached the turning point of the Second World War. Henceforward, the danger was not destruction, but stalemate. To avoid that danger, American forces and supplies had to reach Britain safely, and that meant overcoming the menace of the U-boat. Anglo-American maritime power, a modern term expressing the combined strength of naval and air forces properly woven together, became supreme on and under the surface of the seas and the oceans during 1943. Without this, no amphibious operations on the enormous scale required to liberate Europe would have been possible. Soviet Russia would have been left to face Hitler's whole remaining strength, while most of Europe lay in his grip. During 1943, thanks to the immense shipbuilding program of the United States, the new tonnage at last surpassed losses at sea from all causes, and the second quarter saw, for the first time, U-boat losses exceed their rate of replacement. The time was presently to come when more U-boats would be sunk in the Atlantic than merchant ships. But before this lay a long and bitter conflict. In April 1943, we could see the balance turn. The U-boat packs were kept underwater and harried continually, while the air and surface escort of the convoys coped with the attackers. We were now strong enough to form independent flotilla groups, to act like cavalry divisions, apart from all escort duties. This I had long desired to see. 235 U-boats, the greatest number the Germans ever achieved, were in action. But their crews were beginning to waver. They could never feel safe. Their attacks, even when conditions were favorable, were no longer pressed home, and our Atlantic losses fell by nearly 300,000 tons. In May alone, 40 U-boats perished in the ocean. The German Admiralty watched their charts with strained attention, and at the end of the month, Admiral Dönitz recalled the remnants of his fleet to rest or to fight in less hazardous waters. By June, the sinkings fell to the lowest figure since the United States had entered the war. The convoys came through intact. The supply line was safe. The decisive battle had been fought and won. But it was not the end of the war against the U-boat. Admiral Dönitz did not despair. He hoped to regain the initiative in 1944 with a new type of U-boat, which could move more quickly underwater and travel much farther. At the same time, many of the older boats were withdrawn so that they could be fitted with a snorkel and work in British coastal waters. This new device enabled them to recharge their batteries while submerged, with only a small tube for the intake of air remaining above the surface. Their chances of eluding detection from the air were thus improved, and it soon became evident that the snorkel-fitted boats were intended to dispute the passage of the English Channel whenever the Allied invasion was launched. What happened will be narrated in due course. It is high time to return to the Mediterranean scene and the month of July 1943. Husky, as the capture of Sicily was called in our code names, was an undertaking of the first magnitude. Although eclipsed by events in Normandy, its importance and its difficulties should not be underrated. The landing was based on the experience gained in North Africa, and those who planned Overlord learned much from Husky. In the initial assault, nearly 3,000 ships and landing craft took part, carrying between them 160,000 men, 14,000 vehicles, 600 tanks, and 1,800 guns. These forces had to be collected, trained, equipped, and eventually embarked, with all the vast impedimenta of amphibious warfare, at widely dispersed bases in the Mediterranean, in Great Britain, and in the United States. In spite of anxieties, all went forward smoothly and proved a remarkable example of joint staff work. For reasons of policy, we had hitherto yielded the command and direction of the campaign in North Africa to the United States. But now we had entered upon a new stage, the invasion of Sicily, and what should follow from it. It was agreed that action against Italy should be decided in the light of the fighting in Sicily. As the Americans became more attracted to this larger adventure, instead of being content for the rest of the year with Sardinia, and while the prospects of another joint campaign unfolded, I felt it necessary that the British should be at least equal partners with our allies. The proportions of the armies available in July were British, 8 divisions, United States, 6. Air, the United States 55%, British 45%. Naval, 80% British. Besides all this, there remained the considerable British armies in the Middle East and in the Eastern Mediterranean, including Libya, which were independently commanded by General Maitland Wilson from the British headquarters at Cairo. It did not seem too much in these circumstances that we should have at least an equal share of the high command. And this was willingly conceded by our loyal comrades. We were, moreover, given the direct conduct of the fighting. Alexander was to command the 15th Army Group, consisting of the 7th United States Army under General Patton and the 8th British Army under Montgomery. Air Chief Marshal Tedder commanded the Allied Air Force, and Admiral Cunningham the Allied Naval Forces. The whole was under the overall command of General Eisenhower. Intense air attack upon the island began on July the 3rd, with the bombing of airfields both there and in Sardinia, which made many unusable. July the 10th was the appointed day. On the morning of July the 9th, the great armadas from east and west were converging south of Malta, and it was time for all to steam for the beaches of Sicily. The morning was fine, but by noon a fresh and unseasonable northwest wind sprang up. During the afternoon, the wind increased, and by evening there was a heavy swell, which would make landings hazardous, particularly on the western beaches in the American sector. The landing craft convoys plunging northward from Malta and from many African ports between Bizerta and Benghazi were having a rough voyage. The bad weather helped to give us surprise. Admiral Cunningham commented, "The very efficient cover plan and deceptive routing of convoys played their part. In addition, the vigilance of the enemy was undoubtedly relaxed, owing to the unfavorable phase of the moon. Finally came this wind, dangerously close at the time to making some, if not all, of the landings impracticable. These apparently unfavorable factors had actually the effect of making the weary Italians, who had been alert for many nights, turn thankfully in their beds, saying, 'Tonight, at any rate, they can't come.' But they came. Our airborne landings experienced grave difficulties, and many men were lost, but the seaborne landings were everywhere successful. The battle for Sicily took 38 days. Mastery in the air was much to our advantage, and over 1,100 enemy planes were destroyed or captured. However, contrary to our hopes, the main German forces managed to retreat across the Straits of Messina to the mainland. On the 17th of August, General Alexander cabled the news that the last German soldier was flung out of Sicily, and the whole island is now in our hands. Our next strategic move was still in suspense. And should we cross the Straits of Messina and seize the toe of Italy? Should we seize the heel at Taranto? Or should we land higher up the west coast in the Gulf of Salerno and capture Naples? Or again, must we restrict ourselves to the occupation of Sardinia? The progress now achieved clarified the scene. On July the 19th, a strong force of American bombers had attacked the railway yards and airport at Rome. Havoc was wrought, and the shock was severe. The speedy collapse of Italy became probable. The Americans, however, held that none of the operations elsewhere, especially overlord, should be prejudiced by more vigorous action in the Mediterranean. This reservation was to cause keen anxiety during the landing at Salerno. While somewhat sharp discussions were in progress, the scene had been completely transformed by the fall of Mussolini. Mussolini's position had been deteriorating, in tandem with Italian military setbacks. The invasion of Sicily by Anglo-American forces was a fatal blow for his regime. In vain did he try to strengthen his position by changes in the military and political hierarchies. General Ambrosio, chief of the general staff, and the Duke of Acquaroni, the minister of court, had the confidence of the king and had been maneuvering to oust the Duce for some time. For his part, the king had been in touch since February 1943 with Marshal Badoglio in the hope that he might head a new government. The chief actor in the final drama now appeared on the scene. Dino Grandi, veteran fascist, former foreign minister and ambassador to Britain, a man of strong personal determination, who had hated the Italian declaration of war upon Britain, but had hitherto submitted to the force of events, arrived in Rome to take the lead at the meeting of the Grand Council. He called on his old leader on July the 22nd and told him brutally that he intended to propose the formation of a national government and the restoration to the king of the supreme command of the armed forces. When the Grand Council met on the 24th of July, the outcome was a foregone conclusion. It was after 2 o'clock in the morning when the voting took place. "The position of each member of the Grand Council," writes Mussolini, "could be discerned even before the voting. There was a group of traitors who had already negotiated with the crown, a group of accomplices, and a group of uninformed who probably did not realize the seriousness of the vote, but they voted just the same. 19 replied yes to Grandy's motion, and 7 no. 2 abstained. Mussolini rose. You have provoked a crisis of the regime. So much the worst. The session is closed. The party secretary was about to give the salute to the Duce when Mussolini checked him with a gesture, saying, "No, you are excused." They all went away in silence. None slept at home. Meanwhile, the arrest of Mussolini was being arranged. After an audience with the king, he was quietly arrested by a captain of the Carabinieri. Later that afternoon, Badoglio was charged by the king to form a new cabinet of service chiefs and civil servants, and in the evening the marshal broadcast the news to the world. 2 days later, the Duce was taken on Marshal Badoglio's order to be interned on the island of Ponza. Mussolini's fatal mistake was the declaration of war on France and Great Britain following Hitler's victories in June 1940. Had he not done this, he could well have maintained Italy in a balancing position, courted and rewarded by both sides, and deriving an unusual wealth and prosperity from the struggles of other countries. Even when the issue of the war became certain, Mussolini would have been welcomed by the Allies. He had much to give to shorten its course. He could have timed his moment to declare war on Hitler with art and care. Instead, he took the wrong turning. He never understood the strength of Britain, nor the long-enduring qualities of island resistance and sea power. Thus he marched to ruin. His great roads will remain a monument to his personal power and long reign. At this time, Hitler made a crowning error in strategy and war direction. Hitler had, in fact, made a spider's web and forgotten the spider. He tried to hold everything he had won. Enormous forces were squandered in the Balkans and in Italy, which could play no part in the main decisions. A central reserve of 30 or 40 divisions of the highest quality and mobility would have enabled him to strike at any one of his opponents advancing upon him and fight a major battle with good prospects of success. Instead, plans were made to rescue Mussolini, to occupy Rome, and to support Italian fascism wherever possible. If Badoglio signed an armistice with the Allies, further plans were drawn up for seizing the Italian fleet and occupying key positions throughout Italy, and for overawing Italian garrisons in the Balkans and in the Aegean. "We must act," Hitler told his advisers on July the 26th. "Otherwise the Anglo-Saxons will steal a march on us by occupying the airport. The fascist party is at present only stunned and will recover behind our lines. The fascist party is the only one that has the will to fight on our side. We must therefore restore it. All reasons advocating further delays are wrong. Thereby we run the danger of losing Italy to the Anglo-Saxons. These are matters which a soldier cannot comprehend. Only a man with political insight can see his way clear." Prospects of victory in Sicily, the Italian situation, and the progress of the war made me feel the need in July for a new meeting with the president and for another Anglo-American conference. It was Roosevelt who suggested that Quebec should be the scene. Mr. Mackenzie King welcomed the proposal, and nothing could have been more agreeable to us. No more fitting or splendid setting for a meeting of those who guided the war policy of the Western world could have been chosen at this cardinal moment than the ancient citadel of Quebec, at the gateway of Canada, overlooking the mighty St. Lawrence River. We assigned to it the name Quadrant. I left London for the Clyde, where the Queen Mary awaited us, on the night of August the 4th, in a train which carried the very heavy staffs we needed. We were, I suppose, over 200, besides about 50 Royal Marine orderlies. The scope of the conference comprised not only the Mediterranean campaign, now at its first climax, but even more the preparations for the cross-channel design of 1944, the whole conduct of the war in the Indian theater, and our share in the struggle against Japan. For the Channel crossing, we took with us 3 officers sent by Lieutenant General F.E. Morgan, Chief of Staff to the Supreme Allied Commander, yet to be finally chosen, who, with his combined Anglo-American staff, had completed our joint outline plan. As the whole of our affairs in the Indian and Far Eastern theatres were under examination, I brought with me General Wavell's Director of Military Operations, who had flown specially from India. I also took with me a young brigadier named Wingate, who had already made his mark as a leader of irregulars in Abyssinia, and had greatly distinguished himself in the jungle fighting in Burma. These new brilliant exploits won him in some circles of the army in which he served the title of the Clive of Burma. I decided to take Wingate with me, and as I knew how much the President liked meeting young, heroic figures, I had also invited Wing Commander Guy Gibson, fresh from leading the attack which had destroyed the Mona and Ada dams. These supply the industries of the Ruhr and fed a wide area of fields, rivers and canals. A special type of mine had been invented for their destruction, but it had to be dropped at night from a height of no more than 60 feet. After months of continuous and concentrated practice, 16 Lancasters of No. 617 Squadron of the Royal Air Force attacked on the night of May the 16th. Half were lost, but Gibson had stayed to the end, circling under fierce fire over the target to direct his squadron. He now wore a remarkable set of decorations: the Victoria Cross, a Distinguished Service Order and Bar, and a Distinguished Flying Cross and Bar, but no other ribbons. This was unique. My wife came with me, and my daughter Mary, now a subaltern in an anti-aircraft battery, was my aide-de-camp. We sailed on August the 5th, this time for Halifax in Nova Scotia, instead of New York. During the voyage, I discussed Overlord in detail with the chiefs of staff. How and where were we to enter occupied France? The choices lay between the Pas-de-Calais and Normandy. The Pas-de-Calais would enable us to mount the best air cover, and it was the shortest route back to France. But senior military officers, including Mountbatten, favored Normandy. It was hoped by us that German thinking would note that there was no harbor capable of sustaining a large invasion force, and thus only relatively light forces would be assigned to defend Normandy. The challenge that confronted us was to overcome this lack of a suitable harbor. I had been abreast of all the thought about landing craft and floating piers. Developing ideas from all this, Commodore J. Hughes Hallett in June 1943 came forward with the idea of creating large areas of sheltered water. Imagination, contrivance, and experiment had been ceaseless. And now in August 1943, there was a complete project for making two full-scale temporary harbors, which could be towed over and brought into action within a few days of the original landing. These synthetic harbors were called Mulberries, a code name which certainly did not reveal their character or purpose. I was now convinced of the enormous advantages of attacking the Havre-Cherbourg sector, provided these unexpected harbors could be brought into being from the first, and thus render possible the landing and sustained advance of armies of 1 million rising to 2 million men, with all their immense modern equipment and impedimenta. This would mean being able to unload at least 12,000 tons a day. Three dominating assumptions were made, both by the framers of the plan and the British chiefs of staff. With these I was in entire agreement, and as will be seen later, they were approved by the Americans and accepted by the Russians. One, that there must be a substantial reduction in the strength of the German fighter aircraft in Northwest Europe before the assault took place. Two, that there should be not more than 12 mobile German divisions in northern France at the time the operation was launched, and that it must not be possible for the Germans to build up more than 15 divisions in the succeeding 2 months. Three, that the problem of beach maintenance of large forces in the tidal waters of the English Channel over a prolonged period must be overcome. To ensure this, it was essential that we should be able to construct at least 2 effective synthetic harbors. I also had many discussions with the chiefs of staff on our affairs in the Indian and Far Eastern theaters. We had none too good a tale to tell. A division had advanced at the end of 1942 down the Arakan coast of Burma to recapture the port of Akiab. Though strengthened until a complete corps was engaged, the operation had failed, and our troops were forced back over the Indian frontier. Although there was much to be said in explanation, I felt that the whole question of the British High Command against Japan must now come under review. New methods and new men were needed. I had long felt that it was a bad arrangement for the Commander-in-Chief of India to command the operations in Burma, in addition to his other far-reaching responsibilities. It seemed to me that the vigorous prosecution of large-scale operations against the Japanese in Southeast Asia necessitated the creation of a separate Supreme Allied Command. The Chiefs of Staff were in complete agreement and prepared a memorandum on these lines for discussion with their American colleagues in Quebec. There remained the question of the commander of this new theatre, and we were in no doubt that he should be British. Of the various names that were put forward, I was sure in my own mind that Admiral Mountbatten had superior qualifications for this great command, and I determined to make this proposal to the President at the first opportunity. The appointment of an officer of the substantive rank of Captain RN to the supreme command of one of the main theatres of the war was an unusual step. But having carefully prepared the ground beforehand, I was not surprised when the President cordially agreed. The first plenary session was held on August the 19th. Highest strategic priority, as a prerequisite to Overlord, was given to the combined bomber offensive against Germany. The lengthy discussions upon Operation Overlord were then summarized in the light of the combined planning in London by General Morgan. The Chiefs of Staff now reported as follows. Operation Overlord. This operation will be the primary United States-British ground and air effort against the Axis in Europe. Target date, May the 1st, 1944. As between Operation Overlord and operations in the Mediterranean, where there is a shortage of resources, available resources will be distributed and employed with the main object of ensuring the success of Overlord. Operations in the Mediterranean theater will be carried out with the forces allotted at Trident, the previous conference at Washington in May, except in so far as these may be varied by decision of the combined chiefs of staff. As the United States had the African command, it had been earlier agreed between the President and me that the commander of Overlord should be British, and I propose for this purpose, with the President's agreement, General Brooke, the chief of the Imperial General Staff, who, it may be remembered, had commanded a corps in the decisive battle on the road to Dunkirk, with both Alexander and Montgomery as his subordinates. I had informed General Brooke of this intention early in 1943. This operation was to begin with equal British and American forces, and as it was to be based on Great Britain, it seemed right to make such an arrangement. However, as the year advanced and the immense plan of the invasion began to take shape, I became increasingly impressed with the very great preponderance of American troops that would be employed after the original landing with equal numbers had been successful. And now at Quebec, I myself took the initiative of proposing to the President that an American commander should be appointed for the expedition to France. He was gratified at this suggestion, and I dare say his mind had been moving that way. We therefore agreed that an American officer should command Overlord, and that the Mediterranean should be entrusted to a British commander, the actual date of the change being dependent upon the progress of the war. I informed General Brooke, who had my entire confidence, of this change and of the reason for it. He bore the great disappointment with soldierly dignity.